everyone. Thank you. Who's ready for our second to last speaker of the conference? All right. Dr. Michael Clark received his Ph.D. in economics from George Mason University in 2011. He is currently an assistant professor at Hillsdale College, where his hard work and high teaching evaluations garnered him the Wallace and Marion Reemelin Chair in Free Market Economics. Previously, he taught as a visiting professor for the MBA program at the University of Baltimore, where he earned Baltimore's School of Business's Top Teacher Award in 2009. While his passion lies in the classroom, his research has also been fruitful. He has been published in academic journals such as the Adam Smith Review, Reason Papers, and the Independent Review. He has been featured in speaking engagements and radio spots across the country, but was raised in and currently lives in the state of Michigan. Without further ado, let's welcome Dr. Clark.
Go. I am excited to be here, you guys. This
Me
is
too.
Wonderful. There we go. Like, we got the energy. You guys are clapping. This is this wonderful thing. And so I'm here to talk to you guys about something really exciting. I want to talk to you guys about parking. Just straight in, man. I can't handle that parallel stuff at this point in time. And if you think I'm kidding, I'm not even kidding. I want to talk to you guys about parking. I think it's amazing. It's like a really cool thing to me.
Can't wait for my license to do that parking, man. Whew!
Right. I want you to think about parking in a rather precarious way. Think about if you were designing where everybody parked, and you wanted the outcome to be as efficient as possible. You wanted people to walk as little as they possibly could. So imagine you have some big box store and your parking lot's all set up and it's just a big old rectangle and you got a building, you know, front and center is the door, and people are gonna come park. They're not gonna fill the entire parking lot, but they're gonna fill, say, 2/3 of it. If you looked at the parking lot from above, where would you start putting people? Where would you fill these cars in, right? You'd put them as close to the door as possible, and then you could fill them in. If you looked at it from above, if you were doing it as efficiently as possible, what shape would it look like? So what shape would you see if you like outlined the cars that you parked, if you made it as efficient as you possibly could, and you could place every car, right? The first car, if this is the doorway, you'd probably put it right front and center, right? Then you'd put one next to it. If you looked down and you outlined all of those cars parked, what shape would it be? Who's got some guesses for me? What do we think? Yeah, what do you think?
A line.
A line? So would
a
we just...
rectangle.
A line straight back, so everybody would just be this way? Or maybe a rectangle, just, you know, we put like three rows this way. Would that be as efficient as we could possibly be? What do you think?
A bell curve?
Maybe kind of like a bell curve or a semicircle, right? So it would look like this. How many people think a line? How many people think a rectangle? How many people think the semicircle? Okay, it's the overwhelming majority and you got it right, right? So you don't really want the rectangle because there could be people in the back corner of the rectangle and they could be made closer if you put them in the middle, even though they're another row back, right? So you could do it the best you possibly could if you were designing things. So if you were the president of parking and you could control where everybody was, that's how you would line them up, right? That would be the most efficient parking we could possibly have. If you lined them all up, that would be the best that could be done. We have it completely designed because you are an amazing parker and you place people right where they should be. What's kind of interesting to me and why I am serious about finding parking fairly interesting is that when we put no one in charge at all, that's basically the shape that we get. So you can go on like Google Earth and look up like some big box store, and what ends up happening is you see a semicircle. Right? And it's not perfect. Even in the picture that I've shown you, there's some gaps here and there. Right? So there's a few holes up there, like here, you know, here and there or whatever. And there's some weirdo, like way out here, right? Like what's he doing? Right? It's not perfect, but it's pretty amazing. And if you guys have ever seen like a Walmart where they have the two doors, what shape is it then? It's kind of like an M. It's like two semicircles connected, essentially. Like this happens all the time. That's kind of a weird thing. And it's even more weird that I'm at a YAF conference telling you about it. But I want you guys to get some insight from that metaphor. I got another game that we're going to play also that we want to kind of tie in, and we're going to try and figure out kind of some lessons from these two metaphors that we have. So the next game that I have is a classic that I always run at these YAF events. They won't let me get away with not running this game. And so we have a game that we're going to play. It's called the Elchin Maze. And I'm going to need 5 people to help me out. And you can win. Actually, you can win some money. Okay, you were so eager to be a part of the game right from the get-go. So I'm going to have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 since you guys were over here. I'm gonna have you guys go right back towards that back black table right back over there. If you guys in the back, you're probably not gonna be able to see on this side that well. If you wanna get up and kind of stand off to the side, you can watch them play, or I'll kind of narrate what's gonna happen. But they're gonna be over here on this side of the floor here. Okay, so this is like a maze-like game. It's called the Elchin Maze. It's named after an economist named Armin Elchin, who wrote a paper on economic theory. And I turned it into a game. All right? The maze is basically this. Their goal is to get over to me on this side. So they're on that side. Their goal is to come over to me onto this side, right? But the problem is that there's some kind of stoppers along the way. So there's underneath what they have, there's some stuff that says, hey, yep, keep going, you're still alive. And then there's some stuff that says you can't go any farther, right? Every single time you guys make it over to me, you get a quarter. So I got a bag full of quarters over here. I'm gonna pay you off. Every time you get through, you get a quarter. So if you get through the same way 7 times in a row, you're gonna get 7 quarters out of this, right? You keep coming through enough times, maybe you can afford to buy a book out there. I don't know, right? So we're gonna see if you can go through. I'm gonna walk you through the first step, ask you guys if you have any questions, and then I'll unleash you. So we'll make sure that you know what you're doing as you're going through, okay? So we're just gonna kind of demo this. I'm gonna go real slow. I'm gonna have you step up. What you're gonna do is just come up and you're gonna flip over A1 here. And what does it say?
Go.
It says go. So that's a good sign. She has now made it and she's clear to this spot right here, right? So you flip it back to the A1, right? So you're gonna come up, you try B1. And it says go. So then flip it over. All right, next person try C1. A go, all right. Next person try D1. And it's not good, right? So what he would have to do is basically start all over. He doesn't have to just continually be in the D column and like constantly getting it wrong or something like that. He can start wherever he wants after that. You can only go one spot at a time. You can go forward, you can go sideways, you can go diagonal, right? But you can only go one spot at a time. If you get to a point, say here, and you get an X, you gotta start back over. Right, so you gotta start all the way over, and we're gonna keep flipping them down as we go through. All right? Questions? Yes?
So
you can go diagonal, yep. So the only real rule is you can only go one spot. So you can go like here, then here, but you can't do this, right, or something like that. You can go one spot at a time. All right? Once if you know, like, I've been through this 17 times, Dr. Clark, and I know this is go, and this is go, and this is go. You can kind of just, you don't have to flip it every single time. All right, once you absolutely know where you're at and things like that. Yeah? I'm just gonna unleash you and let you guys roll. Good? All right, every time you get through, you get a quarter. Ready? All right, she's good. Go ahead. Go ahead. So you just flip it back down. Every time you get through, you get a quarter. If I can open a plastic bag. You guys can groan. There you go. What a gentleman. My mistake is all of our gain.
What's your name?
My name?
Yeah, so I can return it to you later.
Michael.
Michael, okay.
Good job, Michael. There is a way through. This isn't like some cruel trick where I'm like, ha, ha, ha.
Can we help them?
Oh, yeah. Oh, every time you get through, you get one.
Money.
You got two. That was a good one. Come on, Emma.
You can just restart.
Hey! All right. All right, you guys get the idea, yeah? Okay, all right, we're all done with this. Give him a hand, grab a seat. Sorry, I'm out. I'm out at this point.
Thank you.
Yep. So, parking and a maze. In both of those situations, one of the key things that I want to kind of have you guys think about is that there was order there and nobody like was actually in charge. So in the parking example, I started off and I said, hey, imagine if I was in charge and I could place everybody where I wanted to. Neat. I could place people in a good way when we're parking. But why I said it was interesting is because no one actually was in charge, and yet we park as efficiently as possible anyway. We create the best possible shape that we can. In this situation with the maze, no one's in charge again. No one had like this master plan where they're saying, all of you guys go here. We just kind of saw what had happened. There's a couple of people over here in the audience even who were like, that's not gonna work. You need to go here. And then all of a sudden, once they had that, boom. They got through real fast. Nobody was really in charge, but our actions nonetheless made sense, and they were filtered in a particular way that helped us out. This is actually why I'm here, is to provide these metaphors for what happens in a free enterprise system. You guys, at your last talk, you guys heard about the fourth pillar that he put forward of the United States, and it was that we had a free enterprise system, right? What I want to do is help you guys appreciate and understand why is that so unique and how does that actually work out? Because we want to think about what's really happening here, because we're not in control in designing our economy when we have a free market system. No one's saying, this is the best answer. This is the way to do it. We didn't just sit down and listen to Ben Franklin, who had a good idea about everything in the economy and this is how the world would work. Instead, what we did is we had no one in charge. Let that sink in for a minute, right? Like, if we were driving a large boat, a ship out at sea, and we wanted to get somewhere, and somebody said, ah, the best way to get somewhere is to have no one be in charge of where we're going. You would say, that's ridiculous. That's kind of, that doesn't make any sense. And yet with an economy, that's exactly what I'm saying, is that we ought not to have anyone in charge. Let our own actions just be filtered to these good outcomes. Economists call this spontaneous order, a concept that I want you guys to leave here with a number of different examples, so you can think about how no one's in charge, and yet we end up with good outcomes. It's called of human action, but not of human design. Nobody designs the outcome of the parking lot. There's not somebody in charge saying, hey, we have to have this semicircle. But is it nonetheless an outcome of human action? Of us following kind of our own incentives? Why do we end up making the semicircle? Like, why don't we end up in a bad outcome? Why do we get a semicircle? You gotta have the shortest walk to the door. So if you park somewhere that's really far away, you're going to face those costs, right? But if you find a nice little short spot, oh, you get in there, great. You guys, what's really interesting to me about parking is that we all have different preferences about it, and yet we still end up with that semicircle. How many of you guys are like my wife, who wants to sit there and think if she found the perfect parking spot or not, and go up and down the aisle a couple times just to make sure there's not one better? And how many of you guys are like me, who will be that weird guy in the back who's like, ah, I got a spot and I just take it, right? There's different trust me. There's people out there who, they gotta get that spot. They gotta drive up and down. They gotta get these spots, right? These different preferences of you just going out there and doing whatever you think is best for you, you get feedback from this system. And together we end up, via spontaneous order, actually making the best possible shape that we could. Why is it that spontaneous orders can achieve something that is seemingly kind of crazy? So another example of this would be, imagine a sack of potatoes. You're holding a sack of potatoes. Does anybody think potatoes are really smart and they figured everything out? No, right? I hope not. Otherwise, I don't know, right? Potato head, don't know. Take a sack of potatoes, shake it, and the potatoes will reduce the volume as much as possible in that sack. Potatoes aren't smart, they're not figuring it out. All you have to do is shake the sack and it'll get the lowest in there, right? So it could be all clumpled up. That's spontaneous order. It's not happening by, hey, placing everything perfectly by some design. It's happening through these interactions that are there. What spontaneous orders can achieve is simply astonishing, and it comes from a free enterprise system. So I want you guys to think about what these spontaneous orders in a free society can achieve. Because in an unfree society, what can we come up with? We can come up with solutions to problems that we can comprehend and say, hey, this is probably the best way to do things. What I want to show you guys is that not only by having no one in charge can we get to like good outcomes, but we actually can get to even better outcomes than we could possibly imagine. That's weird. It's not even just saying, hey, that, you know what, we're trying to take this ship and we want to come all the way across the Pacific Ocean and land in LA, because LA is a cool place. But if we don't have anybody steering the ship, not only do we get to LA as fast as possible, but we do one better, and we get to Santa Barbara, right? Yeah, much better, right? We can do things beyond what we could imagine. So I have a story for you guys on this that I tell, called The Evolution of Music. And so what I want you guys to do is to think about this story of music and the thing that holds music as a form of entertainment for us. So not what actually plays the thing, but what actually holds music as a form of entertainment for us, right? So if we go back to the 1920s, what held music in the form of entertainment for us was big bands. Like, it was other people, right? So it's other people are actually holding music as a form of entertainment, right? The 1950s come, and we get records. So you get vinyl records. You guys know vinyl records? Yeah, because it's like retro cool and all this stuff, whatever, right? This is the one that I think you're gonna miss. I'm gonna be impressed if anybody actually knows this. In like the 70s, what comes after vinyl records as what holds music? So a lot of times you guys say cassette tapes. That's the 80s. Oh, I heard it. 8-tracks, hey, all right, vintage there. How many of you guys know what an 8-track is? Okay, some, a couple out there. So in the 70s, we had 8-tracks. In the 80s, we get cassette tapes. I'm a baby of the 80s, had cassette tapes, love cassette tapes. That's where your mixtapes and all that stuff comes from, right? In the 1990s, however, still a kid, and I remember very well, CDs. You guys have to realize how cool CDs were. Think about it. They're like shiny and silver, and they use a laser. I mean, they were really something else when they came out. Like, it was a look at a cassette tape and then look at a CD, and you're like, the future. The future's here. This is great, right? Like, this is awesome. In the 1990s, we knew what would be next as what held music as a form of entertainment for us. And the best knowledge out there said that what would come next would be the mini CD. How many of you guys have heard of mini CDs? They like exist. How many of you guys have heard of like music, mass consumption music being bought and sold on mini CDs? I've never heard of that. It didn't end up happening, right? If you've seen the Men in Black movie series, they actually make reference towards that's what's going to be next. So Will Smith like walks in and Men in Black 1 and he's like, oh, what's this? And he's like, oh, that's what's next. It's gonna be mini CDs. I'm gonna have to buy the White Album again. Like, we knew that would be what's next. That's what held music as a form of entertainment for us. Guys, what actually came next was nothing. It was zeros and ones. It was a thing called an MP3 file. Like, we didn't actually physically have anything. It could be in multiple places at once. It's not what plays it, so some of you guys are like, no, it's an iPod. No. That's like the Walkman or the Discman or the record player. What actually held music was nothing. So let's think about this story of the evolution of music and how we're moving forward. We go from records, right, to those 8-tracks and cassette tapes, all the way up to those awesome Discmans, right? And we had the CDs. And then finally we end up with the iPod, and what held it was an MP3 file. It was nothing. Now I want you to think about this. Go back to 1992 and tell a 10-year-old Michael Clark, hey, son, I got a story for you. What's held music as a form of entertainment went from big band, other people, to records, to 8-tracks, to cassette tapes, to CDs. And I know you think the mini CDs, what's coming next, because it's smaller and all that kind of stuff, but what's really going to hold it next is going to be nothing. Guys, I wasn't a rocket scientist as a child or anything like that, but even I would sit there and be like, you're an idiot, man. Get out of here, right? Like, it'd be very hard to convince somebody that, hey, that's exactly what would happen, that we would get there, and that's what would be next, right? That's what we would end up having next. Well, how does economic progress actually progress? We like to think of it as coming from us, driving the ship, understanding our way through. Who got through the maze first? Who was it? Do you even know? You? Yeah? What's your name?
Matthew
got through the maze first. Does anybody think Matthew has like some great insight into my mind as to how I set up mazes or something like that? Like, he figured it all out at the start. That Dr. Clark guy, he looks like a straight, diagonal guy. Right? No, Matthew didn't know these things in advance. How did Matthew get through, though? It was trial and error, right? He got feedback and was told there was no grand design. It was trial and error through the fog of the unknown and getting this feedback and saying, yes, this works, no, this doesn't work. Just like, hey, if you don't like walking and you park for forever away, what happens to you? You get some feedback in that You're like, this stinks. I don't want to walk this far next time. You get feedback in a market economy in the exact same way. If you provide value for other people, you are rewarded for, in essence, getting through that maze. If you don't provide value for other people, you're punished. You have to face the consequences of not getting through that maze. And you have to learn from that. Most of what we do and most of what we know in an economy and as individuals comes from this trial and error process in learning. Learning as individuals and learning as a group. We don't figure it out. The system helps us figure it out. How do we progress farther and farther into the future? How do we make this progress such that we end up with answers like nothing being what we actually get in the evolution of music story? I mean, that's beyond my imagination when I was a 10-year-old child, and I got news for you. There was grown adults during the 1990s, and it was beyond their imagination as well. And yet for you guys, you look back, and it's an obvious story. It's an easy story. It's one that doesn't seem that revolutionary or that amazing that we made that leap. But how do we actually do this? Knowing how to create progress is not an easy task. We don't know, we don't have it figured out, but it's that spontaneous order, that trial and error, that feedback, that's the main message of a free enterprise system and how we move forward. A market-based society, it's the set of institutions, the rules of the game, the way that we have the rules set up, that's what handles the cognitive burden of figuring out what's next. And it rewards those who can figure out what's next better. We don't have any idea what's next. We don't have any idea what's now. Think about all of the things that you did today, and how many of them do you have any clue as to how to do for yourself? When you turned a light on, anybody think they can do that from scratch? Right? As you put your clothes on, your shoes on, as you got food, all of these different things that you did, none of you had to think about how do I actually execute this other than just consuming it. We can't figure everything out, and in fact, it's because we can't figure everything out that we can have so much. Right? So a famous quote about this idea, or a famous little joke about this idea, comes from Carol Nichols. This is my favorite tweet of all time. Right? My favorite tweet of all time that gets through this. Think about what this says up here, right? You guys don't understand, if you're not old enough, how real this was. In 1998, don't get in strangers' cars. That was like a duh, no-brainer. Don't meet people from the internet. That was a huge thing. The internet was just becoming this social thing. Oh my gosh, it's so dangerous. And then it's like Uber. We have no idea what's next. We have no idea what's now. We think we understand the world around us and that it's because of us, but the reality is it's not because of our knowledge, it's because of our lack of knowledge as to what is happening, that we allow for everybody to specialize in what they do, and we reap the rewards from it. And all of those people, how do they know what to do? Is it from them figuring it all out? Is it from them knowing so much better and just being so much smarter? No, it's from them doing the trial and error process and getting this feedback, right? Civilization advances by extending the number of important operations which we can perform without thinking about them. If we think about this, what spontaneous order can do, and it can do beyond what we can imagine. I want you guys to think about this, and I don't want you to leave here having a one-off econ lesson and thinking that what I am saying is it's all about just rich, wealth, more, because that is the stereotype of economics. And yes, we do get more, But I think what we get more of is not just the wealthy stuff of my fourth Rolex that I afford and all of this kind of thing or whatever. I think spontaneous order allows for responsible individuals to build a better lives for themselves, to act better, to have virtue, and to put these things together in an interesting way. And I go back to the parking lot. Because we said, oh, there were some gaps in the parking lot, right? There's some holes in there. And that's what people like to do when they think about a free enterprise system, is they point out, oh, not everything is absolutely perfect. And look at that guy way off in the corner, right? And I kind of made fun of my wife. My wife sits there and she drives up and down, whereas I just park right away. I got another one for you. My brother-in-law with his wife, they go and they park, and he parks way in the back like the crazy guy. And his wife kind of looks at him, because she's just like my wife. She's like, come on. And he says to her, you got two good feet, use them. Guys in the room, dating advice, don't ever do that. My brother-in-law sounds like scum. He's one of the best guys that I know of on the face of this planet. And the fact that he says, you got two good feet, you can use them, I actually think is noble. He genuinely means it. He says, we're going to park in the back because we are relatively young, we do have two good feet, and we can park back here. And when his wife was pregnant, he did what he hated to do. He did what my wife does, and he drove up and down and made sure she didn't have to walk that far. So it turns out that our parking lot, when we act on our own accord, is actually better than one that could be designed by me, the president of parking, doing as efficient as possible and making a semicircle. It's better than that. Because we get these acts of other people, of kindness and things that can reflect our preferences better than somebody could actually design. These things come together and they can showcase the best in us. And if it tries to showcase the worst in us, we get punished. It's a profit and loss system, and it does make gains for things that really matter. The imagination of our head is limited, but the imagination of a free enterprise system is seemingly unlimited. If we look at things through time, we see these creations, these outcomes, and there are four things that genuinely matter to us, not my fourth Rolex because I'm so loaded. So I want to end with a personal story. This is a true story of me and my family. So this is pictures of me and my family. I have four kids. There's kind of like a built-in spoiler alert to this story. I have four children. That's my wife there with the four kids. They're all kind of scattered throughout, right? I want to tell you guys about how we started to grow as a family. So my oldest son, bottom right corner there, he plays disc golf. He's awesome. So does, that's my, in the left side, my oldest daughter does too. But my oldest son, when he was born, we were living in Northern Virginia, and he was born in July. Does anybody know anything about Northern Virginia in July? It's hot. Pregnant women don't like hot. It's not a good combo, right? And so my wife and I, what we were doing is we were going to the shopping malls, and we were just sitting there and walking around and like looking at stores going, yep, that store's still there. And then we'd keep walking and doing these loops because it was so air conditioned and we could be there. And we had to keep our head off of it, right? We were getting all nervous about things. Quite frankly, no one in my side of the family had children before me. I understand other people had children, right? Like that, throughout all of time, people had children before I did. But I had not been like close to it in my life. I hadn't really been around this experience, right, or anything like that. And so I didn't know, I was just super nervous, all this stuff, we're building up all this anxiety and stuff, right? And we would go to the movies at the mall. So there's a movie theater there. And after seeing Twilight 2 for the fourth time, we went home and my wife says to me, hey, I got a headache. And so I tell her, get to bed, right? I'm an awesome husband. She goes to bed, she wakes up in the morning and she says, hey, I still have a headache. And I was like, oh man, I don't know, whatever. She, on the other hand, had read 17 books about having your first child and, you know, all these meetings we had to go to. She paid attention in those classes that we went to and stuff, right? Like, she was like, hey, I'm supposed to call if a headache lasts overnight. And I'm like, okay. So they call and they tell her, why don't you head down to the hospital? Now, guys, mind you, I've been spending the last 2 weeks watching Twilight 2 because I am a nervous wreck and I'm trying to keep my mind off of things. So when I hear a phone call from somebody in the know who says, why don't you head down to the hospital? It's not just like a little Sunday drive. I am freaking out. We get there and my wife's like really kind of struggling, all this kind of stuff. They run some real quick basic tests on her. And her blood pressure was like basically through the roof. And it turns out that she had some other complications, but also something called preeclampsia, which is actually more dangerous for the mom than it is for the child. They say to us, hey, we can do an emergency C-section, or we can try and have a natural birth. And to me, I'm like sitting there, and I'm like, what are the pros, what are the cons? And they say, hey, the C-section, there's always risks with surgeries, but we know what we're doing. This has happened a whole bunch of times before. It's, you know, very high probabilities all the way across the board. They also say that if we try and go with the natural birth, we face a little bit more risk. It's more risk for the mother, not as much for the child. There's an obvious answer here, guys. You go with the emergency C-section. And so my wife says, let's try the natural birth. And now my panic is incredibly real. And we're trying to go through things. They're trying to push stuff forward. And she's struggling. The numbers aren't really there. The doctor pulls me out into the hallway and says, listen, I was trained in this. I know what I'm doing. I don't really like where she's heading. I know that this is like inevitably kind of her call. But I think you should at least have a talk with her. We should do the emergency C-section. I did a lot of her residency and her research was actually on like issues of preeclampsia and emergency C-section stuff. And I was told by the other staff that the lady that we had was like the fastest surgeon that they ever knew. And it was like, hey, this is this great, great thing. And so I'm like, okay, I gotta go tell my wife like she's doing it wrong. Right? And so I get on like my male chauvinist pants, right? And I'm like, all right, I'm gonna go in there and be like, this isn't me at all. And be like, woman, you're doing this wrong, right? Or something like that. So I walk into the room and I get in there and I look her in the eyes and I'm like, and she goes, hon, I think we should do the C-section. 25 minutes later, I had a child and they said my wife was fine. That to me is an incredible miracle. I had specialists and equipment and advances in science that we did not have 50 years ago, and we still do not have to this day in countries that do not have free enterprise systems. The equipment that was made available and the research that our doctor did during her residency was not knowledge that had existed prior to that. It was not knowledge that was even thought of 100 years ago as to what we could do in medicine. It was the nothing in my story of the evolution of music. It was something beyond what we could comprehend, and yet we now come to expect it every day. It's commonplace. Of course, you just had a C-section. That's not that big a deal. It was to me. It was a very big deal to me. The act of life itself happened because we had these advances. It's not all about my fourth Rolex. So when individuals try to claim some kind of moral authority or topping you of you, when you support a free society, they think, oh, well, you know, we actually care about people. Yeah, so do I. I think freedom cares for people better. Without freedom and without the advances that we had, I know that I would not have this guy. I wouldn't have her. I wouldn't have her. I might have him, and I probably would not have her. I can promise you guys, I would not be talking to you today without her. The progress that we have is not just all, oh, Dr. Clark's fourth Rolex. It's things that are beyond our imagination, and it is things that actually matter for the way that we live our lives. Understand the beauty of economic freedom is getting beyond what is knowable, beyond what we can even comprehend in our head. Freedom shouldn't be just argued for, as you've often heard throughout this kind of weekend here, as you guys are going through these talks, based on what other systems can't do. There's lots of failures of other systems. And there's pride that free enterprise systems and a system of liberty doesn't have those failures. But it's not just that we don't fail as much in a free society. It should be argued for based on the inspiring hope and its belief in moving beyond what we can currently even imagine. Freedom does incredible things, and it moves us into the unknown. That's the time that I got for you guys. I hope you learned something about the free enterprise system. We got a couple of minutes for questions. Yes, a couple minutes for questions. So you guys can line up.
I don't have a book to give you. Sorry.
So if you guys want to line up over by Kyle, state your name, your school, take off your name tag, and state a brief question.
Hello, my name is Owen Harrison. I'm homeschooled in Southern California. And my question is, where do you think the balance lies between, I guess, like the natural organization and like government control?
Yeah, so the idea here is not that I am saying anarchy, you know, like, yeah, right. Like, let's just go crazy. There is a role for a limited government and setting up the rules and things like that. Like, even in my example, the parking lot, there's lines, right? There's like rules as to what you can do. There's certain structures, but then we allow freedom within that setup, right? We allow some freedom within that. Where exactly to draw the line, I don't think is a knowable, perfect thing. I just know that for me, my kind of preference towards this, what I believe is that, say the right answer is somewhere like here, and we're here, I know it's moving in this direction towards more freedom. I don't know if it gets all the way to perfect freedom or anything like that. I think there's like debates that you can have about this. I don't think it matters because we know we got to push in that direction and we're not really close. And a lot of times in the kind of free enterprise world, we get caught up in these debates about things like this. And like, it's like, privatize the roads, no one will build the roads and stuff like this. And we get in these debates. I don't know. And I don't think it super matters because we're not close. What we know is that we need to move in that direction more so, and we can hash out some of the debates at a later time.
Thank you.
This is our last question.
Hi, I'm Sarah. I'm from Buchanan High School. And my question for you is, do you think that free markets also lead to the evolution of the arts and our culture?
Yeah, so actually my I was a research assistant for a guy named Tyler Cowen. If you look up Tyler Cowen, he has like three or four different books on culture and economics. And the argument is that it actually pushes things forward. So I kind of buy into this, even globalization of a lot of these ideas. So if you think about it, so a lot of people say, oh, well, everything's kind of Americanized and all of these things. Well, what's Americanized? Go walk down the road. I understand we're in one of the wealthiest parts in the world right now, right? But if you just go walk down the road, you can find Vietnamese food, you can find Thai food, you have access to a lot of these cultural things that for almost all of human history, you never had any access to. And that's Americanized, is like this melting pot of different ideas. We always remember modern culture by like oh, there's so much like garbage out there within the culture, but then there's like a few good things. But think about it, anything that happened 100 years ago, we don't know about the garbage because why would we try and remember it? All we remember is like the few great things that were actually there. So there's lots of arguments for what can happen in the arts and different things. Is everything perfect within a free enterprise system? No. Is everything perfect for the arts? No, right? But I do think there's like a reasonable case to be made, much more than most people think, for a lot of these things that are not your stereotypical economic stories, like, hey, can we produce shoes better? Oh, go ask the Economist, what kind of system should we have? Oh, shoes. I think free enterprise systems do a lot of things. There's arguments on multiple sides. You guys have heard lots of things just about the way that you live your lives and how you act and getting to author your own life and the arts and other things that are actually beautiful about life are made more beautiful in a free world. And so I genuinely believe that. There's arguments to be had on both sides, but I think you keep thinking about these ideas. I think truth will out, and I think I'm right about this, but who knows?
Thank you.
Yep.
Let's give another round of applause for Dr. Clark.
Thank you, guys.